Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Manufactoria. We're still working through governance, although we can leave whenever we want. And then work on some kind of space tech? Aerospace. Yeah. So, I assume all these red ones are just too hard to tackle right now, but let's at least have a look at their descriptions. Peacekeeper. Recent disturbances in West Africa had escalated into violence, leaving several dead. I felt compelled to volunteer our services. Who could do a better job of running a police action than a force of unstoppable machines? Make all tasks the same size as the largest one, then produce. Now, I assume zero, I can't just reduce them all to size zero and say, ta-da! Right? I have to actually make them the same size they were when they entered. That would be quite a cheese. But I can't look at anyone else's solutions till I've solved something. So, I mean, we could also just, like, remove everything, and that would also be valid. I assume that sort of cheese is not allowed, and he means all of the incoming, like, preserve the number of tasks, and increase them all to the size of the one that was the largest at the time that it entered. The size the largest was one was when it entered. Wow. What's the idea on this one? Jeez. Well, I have an idea. It seems hard, and I'm also not sure if it's correct. And if it is correct, it's probably not best. But here's my thinking. How do you identify the largest task? You kind of have to. Shrink them all down to size zero and then see which one is left standing, right? When you do that, you're losing information about how big the largest one was. So you can't actually reduce them to size zero. What you can do instead is modify them, replacing blues with yellows as you go, right? So we start by scanning all the tasks, and for each task, as long as we can find a single task with blue in it. Yeah. Let's say there are two tasks with blue, which I really hate. We go through all of the tasks, replacing one blue with one yellow in each task. Then, at some point, we reach a state where there's only one task with blues left. And then we have to, for each of those blues, add a blue, or say a yellow, probably a yellow actually, to every other task. And while we're doing that, we can reduce, we can keep track of how well that's going by every time we do add a yellow to every other task, we replace one blue with one yellow on the current task. That's like an insane multi-pass solution where every pass is like multiple passes and we do multiple of those. So it seems very slow and inefficient. I think we probably don't have to actually do that. We could, for example, um, go over the list of tasks. In each task, consume a blue if you can find it, and write a yellow regardless. At some point, you will go through the entire list of tasks without ever finding a single blue. And when that happens, convert all the yellows to blues and you're done. Now, I don't think that algorithm as described quite works. I think you actually have to pre-process the list, seeing are there any blues left? Because if you reach the state where there are no blues left, and you add a yellow to the first one in order to find that, you might be sad. Although, maybe not. Because if you go through the entire list of tasks, and you find that there were no blues, then you know that every yellow you added in that round doesn't count. And furthermore, you know you added exactly one yellow to each task. So when copying tasks and converting yellows to blues, you can just skip the first one in every task. I think that holds up just fine, even when all the tasks are of length 0. Which is a possibility. So I think that's a description of an algorithm that should work. There are some details in, like, you know, I said copy all of the things and count whether you've ever seen a blue. And of course, you can't, like, remember that on the tape, so you have to, as soon as you read your first blue, you have to fork off to a totally different copy of the state graph. But that seems doable, and it seems like an interesting challenge to work on that will probably take the whole video. But that is okay. So, we start by writing a green. Congratulations. Okay. Already I'm like, the idea is still in my head, but the details of it I have to, like, consult long-term storage for. So the first thing we do, we're going through all the tasks and doing something. Which means we need to be able to re-enter this state after having done something, right? While still not, you know, in addition to when the actual main loop ends and we've transformed one blue to one yellow, we also need to, when we've just finished one task, get back and do this to the rest of the tasks. So we need a scanner here, which I think has to be a red, white, and blue scanner, right? Because we could run into a yellow, and we could run into a green? Yes. We can't run into a green now, because we know... No, we could. There's 0 tasks. Yeah, so we could totally run into a green. Okay. And if we see a blue... Then we need to consume the blue and then, like, enter a copy of the whole machine that remembers we saw at least one blue. I haven't made the first copy of the machine yet. I'm not really equipped to make the second copy. Okay, let's work on the red half first. Something we're gonna need, at any rate, is a green-yellow that feeds back into the same place. This kind of configuration is basically a four-way scanner. So if we read a yellow, it's very easy. We just write the yellow back. That's what this half of the program does. It copies yellows and turns one blue into one yellow. If it's green, then what has happened is we've made it through the entire tape without ever seeing a blue, right? And at that point, okay, so it is possible for there to be zero tasks, right? Yes, I'm supposed to accept this. And the goal is that it be empty. That's a little tricky. Well, no, I could special case that, I suppose, and then have the guarantee that later on there will always be at least one task. So supposing the tape wasn't empty, and I get to here, it means I scanned through all the robots. Because here's what I'm thinking, though, right? Is I probably should write a yellow before I get here. Because remember, my algorithm was to, for every task, increase, give it one new yellow. And then in kind of like a post-processing step, when I'm copying yellows back to blues, skip one of the yellows for each task. And there's not really a good place to write a yellow except for here, I think. So that's why I think I need the special case having none, because if I put a yellow in on my way in on the first bot, the tape would be yellow-green, which is illegal. It would ruin my life, right? Then when I tried to copy that, I would just get confused. So I think, yeah. I mean, I think you could handle it without special casing, probably, but I'm not going to. So the start, actually, is going to be like this. Where oh, it's so hard because if you read nothing then you've modified what was there. I could copy the whole tape before I go in, but I kind of hate that. I could have it be right here, if you read a green stop. So write a green, then check and see if the green that you wrote is the next thing you see, right? And otherwise enter the main program loop area. So, okay, this is gross, I hate it, but like that, right? Let's just put you way far away, so... Is this what I had before? Yeah. So that I don't get confused and think this is part of the main program, and I'll just route around it somehow. So, now if I get here with a green, I'm guaranteed there was at least one task, because I handled the zero task case separately. In which case, I should be writing the yellow in, well, so this is kind of like the inner loop. where I'm replacing a single blue, where I'm adding a yellow in a single task. This is the outer loop where I've processed all tasks. So here I've added a yellow, and then I've copied all the remaining yellows without seeing a blue? I may have seen a red, but I won't have seen a blue. I say that because in the red case, where I've emptied a single task, what I want to do is write the task back and then just get to here, right? So I write the end of the task, and then I add a yellow to the next task and go looking for blues in it. And if I find a red, then I'm done with this task as well. Okay, yeah, this looks right. Now, if I get a green, then I processed all of the tasks without without seeing a single blue. But I did add a yellow to every task. Even in the case there were zero tasks, one task rather, I added a yellow to it. And even if that task was empty, I added a yellow. Didn't I? Yeah, right here. Okay, so what that means is here, I should start turning the yellows back into blues. Which is straightforward enough. I think I need to write the green back out, don't I? So I know when I'm done. It's perfect because it gives me a reason to be over here. And then I'm entering, like, an inner loop, right? I need to loop over all tasks, and then within each task, I need to loop over all their yellows. So I think I'm gonna need this to let me re-enter the inner loop. Or the outer loop? The outer loop. I need like a red, green, yellow scanner, but they don't make those. Because I won't find any blues. But okay, now I'm at the beginning of a task. And my job is to remove a single yellow, which I know exists at the beginning, right? And then copy all yellows until I see a red. So in this case, a yellow-red scanner is fine. Those are the only colors that can appear. There can't be a green. And I think if it's red, I just write the red back. I've finished that task, and then I go up here and look for the next task. If it's yellow, I think I write the yellow back, right? No, idiot, I write a blue back. And then if I encounter a green, I think I can accept here. And I can't encounter anything else. Wait. Can I encounter a yellow here? Well, of course, yellows go here, right? So if I encounter... I always encounter yellow at the beginning of each task. I come down here. I copy the remaining yellows to blues and turn the red into a red. I come back. Eventually, I see a green and I leave. Okay, so I think we've handled successfully in all this work the identity transformation for inputs with no blues. Right? So if you give me like this, I'll nail it. Watch this. I mean, we should... I don't actually know we'll nail it, but that's what I hope to have nailed anyway. But I wrote the green in, right? And then I wrote a yellow saying, hey, first task, add a yellow to it. There were no other inputs, so we're done with that task. And now I'm finished all the tasks, so I go to green and start copying. And each task gets one fewer blue than it had yellows, so we just write out. A miracle! Oh no, there's an unexpected green? Something went wrong there. Okay, so we reached this point kind of like our invariants were preserved. We read the green, we wrote back the green, and now my job was very simple, I thought. Wait. There's a yellow at the end here. Why is there a yellow at the end? I wrote a yellow after the last task? Ah. Because I'm writing a yellow before I've determined that there's another task. I don't think I could live with this. I don't think I could allow this to happen and then fix it up at the end. It would just be a huge mess. Yeah. I have to not write the yellow. So I think that means the first, when I'm beginning to look at a task, when I've just finished the task and I'm about to start another, I have to read what's there once. It could be yellow, it could be blue, and it could be green, and it could be red. So it could be literally anything. It would only be red if all the tasks were empty, but that still could happen. And if it's yellow or blue or red, I can put a yellow on. But if it's green, I can't do that, and I have to leave. Go to the end bit where we copy everything. Okay. So we already have a setup here that's reading all four things, but that's in the middle of a loop doing something different. We need another setup that reads four things and then enters the loop at the right point, depending on what it sees. If it sees a blue, it comes up here. If it sees a yellow, it writes two yellows, basically, right? Or it writes a yellow and then enters the loop at the point where it's doing yellows, I guess. And if it sees a red, it writes yellow red, and then goes back to the very same four-way input it was looking at. Right, it basically skips that loop because there was no... It did the whole task just by reading the red, basically. So is what I have here actually useful, or do I have to take it apart to make this other thing fit? It reads, it copies yellows. Until it gets to a red, sending it back here. Or a green, sending it forward. That still seems useful. It's in fact very close to what we want to do after we read what's there first, right? Let's take this bit and move it left a bit, so I have room to think about what's going on. So we don't... Hang on. Oh no, I don't want to write a yellow in here yet necessarily. So, as I'm entering this loop, I need a two-way, or a four-way scanner, right? Pointing at itself probably like this. So very much like this one. And if it reads a red, then it writes yellow and then red and goes back to itself because it found an empty task. So let's do that. If it reads a blue, then it can go up to the top half of things and it knows that writing two yellows is okay. So maybe we write one and then join the blue area where it's writing one. If it reads a green, then we're all out of tasks and we can go here, right? So far this looks very similar to what I had a minute ago. The difference is just where I put the yellow. So maybe I can just use this and put a yellow red in this case. No, because it might have already copied some yellows, right? And we don't want to put another yellow in. Or do we? Maybe I put the yellow in. Of course. Of course. I can put the extra yellow in at the end of processing a task instead of the beginning. And then I don't have to worry about potentially like an empty task, right? So maybe this whole idea was not necessary. I think that's correct. So get back over here. Not quite that far, I guess. So write a yellow and then a red when the group is finished. But copy all the yellows that were there. So does this now pass the test case I had before of three reds? It sees a red, it adds a yellow. It sees a red, it adds a yellow. It sees a red, it adds a yellow. We read the green, and now we reach this area. We replace the green. We reach this area with the input I wanted, which was just a bunch of reds with one yellow each, and we accept. Okay. Good. Now, having done this, do I actually need to special case the empty robot? I think I may not. Or the empty input. Because I'll stamp a green, and I'll get all the way through to here, and I'll say, oh, I found a green. I'll write that green back, and I'll go copying, and I'll read this green. So actually, yeah, this whole business is no longer needed. And I can just start there. And I think, in fact, do this as well. I don't think I'll need any way to enter. Well, I can still enter here and here, and that's all I need. I don't need a way to enter after adding the yellow, because the yellow is no longer on that. Okay, so now we have a nice, I think, fairly compact. Although we could tighten this up a bit, couldn't we? By kind of mirroring it a little? Like, this conveyor belt is what I'm getting at. That seems unnecessary. No, I need a conveyor belt because of this loop. But if I put it on the other side, I can avoid going over it on the way through here. So it saves me, like, one tick. If I... horizontally mirror this? That basically does it, right? Let's just make sure that test still works. Yes, okay. So now, we've handled inputs with only reds. All we have to do is handle blues. It should be easy. And I say that facetiously, but it might not be that hard. Because we've already built, like, the infrastructure of the main loop thing. All we have to do when we find a blue is do basically all of this again. Except that we also have to handle further blues, but that's fine. So when we find a blue, what do we want to do? Well, first thing, let's write a yellow to replace it. Right? And then I think enter another four-way scanner. Where... we're still in the middle of copying the current task. We just know that when we get to the end, instead of going here, we're gonna go here. So I could probably copy, like, this... actually, is it really just this that I'm copying? Am I a genius? I might be a genius. Anyway, so we read a blue, we wrote a yellow. Perfect, right? Now we enter scanners, and I'm just going to write them out by hand, even if it turns out they're duplicates of what I already have. So a green wants to go back this way, We know it's actually impossible to run into a green first. So I could put the red, blue, white scanner here as the first one we run into to kind of optimize for time. But there are two reasons I'm not doing that. One is I want the green node to be able to get here quickly, and this is the quickest path. The other is I think we'll run into yellows pretty often here, and so they'll be efficient anyway. Okay, so that's the yellow edge handled. Now we just need the red-blue scanner, which is a little more exciting, I guess. As long as we are copying blues, we're just replacing blues with blues at this point. Is that correct? Ah, no, this part up here is more complicated. It's not just these, like, five nodes or whatever. Because we want to make sure that for each robot, each task, we only replace its first blue with a yellow. And if we found no blues, we put in a yellow. But if we did find blues, we don't put in a yellow. Okay, so there's gonna be at least two different kind of copying tasks up here. Ugh. So this, if we find a green in this state, how do we describe this cluster of nodes? What are they doing? They're handling They're handling a robot that we found a blue in already. Right? I think so. Actually, it may be more useful for the red to go out this way? I don't know. If we get a green and we're in a robot we found blue in already, we can just leave, right? Go back to the main loop? I think so. We still have to handle the remaining robots in the list. That's what this red is doing. And how do we do that? Well, since we found a blue in this robot, we shouldn't write a yellow. The next thing we're going to need to do is write a red. And let's write it up, because I suspect I'll need to do some more gymnastics up here, including re-entering this node before I come down here. I've read a red now, which means the next node is either red or blue or yellow or green. It could be any of those things. If it's blue, though, I just want to stamp a yellow on and enter this. So I think I can do this. By the way, we're not competing at all for time, space, or stampers. For example, it would be best here for the... if this node detects a blue, to jump to this state, and I don't want to route that out. I'm just going to be happy to have solved four star puzzles, basically. So here, if we find a blue, we stamp a yellow onto it and enter the working on a robot that already has had at least one blue. Great. If we see a red, before seeing any blues in this robot, then we know that this robot had no blues in it. Therefore, we wish to add a yellow to it and move on to the next robot, right? No. We need to add a yellow and replace the red that was there before coming back to this state. Well, fortunately, I have a node that adds a red and comes in here, so okay. So like this. In fact, let's maybe do it that way. So that was what happens if we process a robot that has no blues, but some other robot did. We add a yellow. Now we need the yellow and green handlers for this. I want green to go left so that it can get back here quickly. Yellow's job is very simple. Just copy the yellow that you saw. And I think, I'm sure I've missed something. But I think I've implemented the algorithm I intended to implement. No. Yes. Because if we get to the last robot in here, and it... No, this isn't done. I need to write a yellow and a red back, right? Because this robot didn't have any blues in it. So we need to write an extra yellow for it, and then a red to re... No, wait. This is impossible. There can't be a green here. Because we're in the middle of processing a task, which means there has to be a red at some point. So actually, this can never happen. Something seems wrong there. There's no way to get from this state to this state. If we get a green, there can be a green here, right? So if there is a green, it means I recently processed a red, which I processed that red, replaced it with a yellow and then a red, and then I went in here and I found a green. So in fact, we don't need to write any of those things. We just leave. All right, let's test this on a more exciting input. Just put a blue in there. So it's on the first one, which I don't think makes a big difference. Obviously makes no difference to the intended solution, but I think no difference to my algorithm either. So I read a blue and I wander up into the area where we've found blues. I immediately replace that blue with a yellow on my way in, and then I start copying, but I find a red and I say, oh, this task is done. And it had a blue, so do nothing extra, just write another red. Now I come up here to all these tasks that have no blues, and they say, oh, a red, okay, put a yellow in. A red? Put a yellow in. And I get to here, and this we've already tested, we know it works. So what if I make a more exciting test with two blues? This should be the same. But we'll do our work in this node instead of this one. Or no. Yes? Some of both, I guess. So we read this first robot, and we replace its yellow, okay. And then we come up here, and we read a blue. Which means put a yellow in and enter the robot had blue node. And again, we've made it with the right input. I could just run all at this point, but I do want to try one more thing. Suppose that I add a second blue, like, here. So we know what happens when we get here. Now in this case, we read a yellow, which means we copy it. And then we see a red. And we say, well, for all I know, there's another robot out there with more blues, so I'm writing an extra yellow, just in case. And then this robot starts with yellow, so we copy that, but then it has an actual blue. We go up here and say, okay, yep, we really do need to write a second yellow here. And this guy gets another yellow. Now we go through them all again, adding even more yellows. And then we say, wait a minute, I wasn't supposed to write all those yellows. Okay. A miracle. We solved a level 4 puzzle. The initial prototypes had been heavily armed, but Danica argued a full weapons loadout wasn't a great look for a force of peacekeepers. I admit I was a bit disappointed to see the disarmed versions rolling off the assembly line. The originals weren't a total loss, though. I had them stationed all around the factory for security. I was sure we'd find more uses for them soon. So, no medals, I assume. Yeah. Actually, only 2 excess scanners. That's a surprise to me. Scanners and stampers. And actually almost doing well on area? That's a little shocking as well. Could I move this area up by one? There's lots of space up here. But well, yes, obviously I could. I could reverse the yellow and green arrows on this scanner, right? Yeah, so let's go back to editing this. How do I do that? Back. Take this entire section. And vertical mirror it, right? And that's it. What's my current best? 63? Does it? This still works, right? Like, I'm not crazy? Nice. So doing great on area. In fact, roughly as good as anybody else ever does. Which 2 stampers or scanners are not necessary here? I don't know. Well, okay. Maybe it's the fact that I add an extra yellow and then remove it. Maybe I could have avoided doing that. It seems really hard. I think you have to scan the entire input to decide not to do that, and that involves its own set of copying, right? It adds like 6 extra scanners or something to copy the input. You need, Yeah. And then even more than that, to store the information you received. Huh. It also seems like I should be able to improve the area over here somehow. Like, could I mirror this? I don't think so, because I kind of need... This red is being shared by these two loops, right? And it has to come out of a red here. So, okay, I think I'm not going to work anymore on this one. I'm happy that I got a pretty reasonable time, and, well... Also, all these numbers are divisible by 5. I think there might only be 5 people who solved this puzzle. That would be kind of shocking. It's not that early, it's not like that far along. Huh. Okay, well, I'm happy with myself. Let's get out of here. That's all we did today, right? Did we just do Peacekeeper, or did we, I think we did, yeah. I said I was going to spend the whole video on it, and by God, I did. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.